Today we're going to do some experiments with this 1 pound bottle of propane. And who doesn't like experiments? Technology has changed dramatically, and there are lots of ways to manage energy. So how do I get the most use out of this 1 pound can of propane? Should I burn it? Should I run a hot plate with a generator? Or use the generator to charge my batteries and then run something with the batteries? This is something I want to know, so maybe you do too. Welcome back to Projects with Everyday Dave. Let's run some experiments. We're going to look at two practical use cases. First, in a power outage, your refrigerator is probably high on your priority list of things to power. So what's the most efficient way to use this pound of propane to power my refrigerator? This is a low power, long-term use case that will consider both inverter losses and generator idle losses. Second, in an emergency, heating water is critically important. So what is the most efficient way to heat a pot of water? This is a short but power-intense use case that will bring us closer to the limits of the generator and the inverters. This video is not directly sponsored by anyone. Usually companies are looking for dedicated reviews of their products, and I would rather just do projects and experiments. So I really appreciate the companies that provided products for this experiment, and while I have no obligation to promote them, as you'll see in this video, some of them are pretty great. If you do want to purchase any of them, I've placed links in the description of this video, and using those links helps the channel at no cost to you. Plus, you'll find some exclusive discounts just for my viewers, like $50 off this dual fuel generator. So be sure and check them out, and let's get started testing the fridge. To find the max fridge runtime, I'm going to run two scenarios using this inverter generator that Max Petingrod sent me for this experiment. It has a high efficiency, low idle mode and a built-in inverter that can deliver 3200 watts on propane and 3600 watts on gasoline. I could use my 20 pound propane tank for this test, but using these smaller canisters will allow for more precise measurements of fuel by weighing it before and after using this gram scale. The first method is to charge these 48 volt SOK server rack batteries using this very efficient Victron Multi Plus 2 charger. I'll track the watt hours I put into the batteries and then see how long the fridge can run using the power stored in the batteries. In this case, there are multiple conversion losses, resulting from converting AC to DC and then back from DC to AC. Plus, we'll have the idle losses of the inverter when the fridge isn't running. Second, I'll run the fridge directly from the generator. We won't have all the conversion losses, but there is one big inefficiency. A fridge isn't running constantly, and even at low idle, the generator is consuming some fuel while it waits for the fridge to kick back on. Which do you think is going to be better? Make your guess, and let's get started with the test and see if you're right. All right, I went through my supply of propane canisters and found two that are exactly the same weight. When I weigh them on the scale, they're both 855 grams, and I've labeled them on the back side so that we'll have the same amount of propane for both tests, and I'll weigh them afterwards to make sure I know exactly how much was actually consumed. The regulator that the generator comes with is designed to hook to a regular 20 pound propane tank, so I have this special adapter that will allow me to connect to these smaller propane tanks, and it has a little valve on it so I can exactly control when the propane is flowing. All right, let's fire it up and charge some batteries. I have an adapter to convert from 120 to my 240 connection, since this only puts out 120. My canister of propane, I'm going to set it in this bucket just to hold it upright for me. Just have to connect the propane the generator. Now open the valve. And start it up. There she goes. 0 watts. Should pick up as soon as the inverter recognizes the generator's on. You can see we're putting in exactly 60 hertz, 122 volts and 14.5 amps, fluctuating around there a bit. And it's outputting almost 55 volt and 30 amps to the battery. All right. Mains on, charging away. Ooh. I guess winter isn't the best time for this test. The propane bottle pressure dropped so fast, I lost sufficient pressure to keep the generator running. I dropped the inverter power demand from 15 amps to 10 amps, and I added some hot bags to keep the bottle warm for the rest of the test. I was able to add 700 0.4 watt hours to the batteries. If I extrapolate that to exactly 1 pound or 454 grams, the input would have been 702.9 watt hours. I was then able to run the fridge using that 702.9 watt hours for 6 hours and 37 minutes. So, do you think the generator can run the fridge on this small canister for more than 6.5 hours? Let's see. All right, I plugged the fridge into the generator and I'm running it through a watt meter so I can measure exactly how much power we consume through the test. All right, propane's connected. Some hot bags around it to keep it from getting cold too fast. Let's turn on the propane. I have it set to low idle mode, so it'll run as efficiently as possible. Let's start it up. All right, let's give this equation a little bit of perspective. This 1 pound bottle of propane holds 6,321 watt hours of energy. And that is actually slightly more than this 48 volt server rack battery, which holds 5,120 watt hours. The challenge is getting the energy out of this can and making usable work with it. Now, there isn't a way to take 100% of this energy and use it to run a refrigerator or some other appliance. You have to convert it to electrical energy first. And this is one of the reasons cars have such a big problem. You can put a lot of energy in a very small space with fuels like propane and gasoline. Batteries are very heavy and they take up a lot of space. But the other part of the equation is the efficiency. Internal combustion engines lose a tremendous amount of energy to heat and friction losses, converting 30% or less of the fuel's energy to useful work. That heat can be used to keep the cabin of the car warm in winter or your hands warm with your generator, but generally it's not put to good use. The most efficient way we currently have to turn propane or hydrogen or some other fuel into electricity would be with a fuel cell, and those are only up to 60% efficient. But just for argument's sake, let's say we could get 100% of the energy out of this fuel. That would mean we could run our refrigerator for 71 hours and 19 minutes, assuming 100% efficiency. So that would be our absolute upper limit. With that in mind, let's look at our first result, running from propane in a generator to the inverter, from the inverter to the batteries, and then from the batteries back to the inverter, and from the inverter to the refrigerator. In that situation, consuming the entire can of propane, our fridge was able to run for 6 hours and 37 minutes. The total available energy of 6,321 watt hours divided by the 586 watt hours that we actually were able to use at the fridge gives us an efficiency of 9.3%. That may seem pretty abysmal, but you have to realize the internal combustion engine of the generator is actually very inefficient at consuming fuel. And then we converted it multiple times, charging batteries and then back from batteries to the inverter, and there's losses at every stage of that situation. So now let's look at using the propane on the generator to directly run the refrigerator. Using the entire can of over 6,000 watt hours of energy, we were only able to make use of 104 watt hours, which is a 1.7% efficiency, and only gave us 1 hour and 10 minutes of runtime. Now, that's actually the result I anticipated getting because the refrigerator isn't running all the time. And the whole time the refrigerator is just sitting there, the generator has to continue running on idle, consuming some amount of fuel. And we've already talked about how inefficient internal combustion engines are, but I was pretty surprised at how dramatic the difference was. So the moral of the story here, if you have intermittent loads like a refrigerator that turns on and off, you are way better off putting the energy into a storage system like a battery that can deliver it out when it's needed, instead of having a generator that runs continuously consuming fuel, whether it's needed or not. Well, that was a pretty interesting result, and I really enjoyed running that test. Now we have a completely different test, heating water, and I think we're going to get completely different results. So let's run that. All right, let's see what is the most efficient way to heat up a pot of water. Is it more efficient to use a propane tank and a propane burner and heat it directly? Or should I use the propane to run a generator and use the inverter to charge batteries and then use the batteries to run an induction plate? Or use the propane to run the generator and use the generator to run the hot plate? In order to prove this out, I have weighed out exactly 1.5 kilograms of water in this pot. I've measured the starting temperature, and I've weighed the starting weight of this canister of propane. I'll use the starting and ending weight of the canister of propane for each test, for charge time on the batteries, for burn time on the burner, and for run time on the generator. I also have this kilowatt meter that will allow us to measure the exact consumption of power by the hot plate. After collecting all this data, we'll be able to determine which is the most efficient solution. Before we get started, make sure you've marked in your mind what you think is the most efficient way to use this propane to heat this pot of water from room temperature to boiling. You got it? All right, let's get started. All right, I've weighed my canister pre-test. I have 1.5 kilograms of water in our pot at just over 16 degrees Celsius. So let's see how long it takes to bring it to a boil with direct heat. That is cooking. Wow. Well, there's definitely some excess heat rolling around the outside. Just a matter of, will we lose 90% of our heat that way? I kind of doubt it. The heat gun's a good way to keep track of how close we are. But to get a precise temperature, I'll use the in-water thermometer. It's climbing pretty quickly. That flame is not messing around. That is a nice burner. There's a fair amount of heat rolling around the outside. Very narrow window there to hit. 98, 99, 99.3, and that's about as hot as we can get it. 99.7, I'll call that a rolling boil. 99.8. Shut it off. There we go. Time to weigh it. Let's see what we got. 1.565 kilograms.
Running the hot plate off the batteries was quick and easy. After charging the batteries with the propane powered generator, I plugged the hot plate into my inverter and heated the pot of water from 16 degrees Celsius to approximately 100 degrees Celsius. I recorded the propane to power the batteries, the power delivered by the batteries, and the power consumed by the hot plate.
All right, I've weighed out my propane and my water. It's all set to go. Now we just need to start the generator off this can of propane, and we'll see how much propane it takes to heat the water that way.
I used hot bags to keep the canister warm since the hot plate will draw around 1500 watts and consume propane very quickly. I love the electric start on this generator. It starts so quickly and easily every time. There will be a few seconds of lost energy between generator startup and turning on the hot plate, but I think that will be negligible. Using the watt meter allows me to track exactly how much power the hot plate consumes. I used this particular watt meter because it doesn't lose its memory when the power shuts off. I have a link to it under tools on my website, projectswithdave.com. The generator meter seems fairly accurate, showing about 1.5 kilowatts and provides the power no problem. The water comes to a boil in about 9 minutes, just like when running it off the batteries. Now that I've hit about 100 degrees Celsius, I can quickly shut down the generator and weigh the propane bottle for the final time. So now that we have all the data, let's compare the results. Man, I love experiments, especially when the results are so dramatic. This was so cool. Now, let's do a theoretical max one more time. We can use this simple formula to calculate the change in thermal energy required to raise the temperature of our pot of water. The change in thermal energy is equal to the mass times the coefficient of specific heat times the change in temperature. Entering our numbers into this equation, 1.5 kilograms times the specific heat of water in kilowatt hours per kilogram degree Celsius times our temperature delta of 84 degrees Celsius, we get 0.146 kilowatt hours. Now that's just the energy required to raise the water temperature. We also have to raise the temperature of the pot. So using the same equation, but substituting the weight of the pot of 0.95 kilograms and the specific heat of stainless steel at 0.00014 kilowatt hours per degree Celsius, per kilogram degree Celsius, with the same 84 degree temperature change, we get 0.0111 kilowatt hours for the pot itself. We can then combine them for a total of 0.57 kilowatt hours, or 157 watt hours, to raise both the water and the pot temperature 84 degrees Celsius. So if we take the results from our equation and the entire amount of energy that is stored in this can of propane, we can get a theoretical maximum number of pots of water that can be heated. So from our calculations, it would take 11.3 grams of propane, which is 157 watts, to heat one pot of water. And with the over 6,000 watts that's available in this can, we would actually be able to heat 40 pots of water if we were able to somehow use 100% of the energy in this can to heat water. Now, of course, we don't have a way to use 100% of it. So let's look at the ways that we used. First, the direct flame method, using the burner and burning the fuel directly. In that case, it took us about 7 minutes to raise the 1.5 liters of water, 84 degrees Celsius, and it consumed only 25 grams, which was way better than I thought. I mean, I could feel a lot of heat coming out from around it as it was burning, and I thought we were losing more than half the power, which we were a little bit more, but I thought it would be way more than that. So in our case, it used 348 watt hours of power, or 45% efficiency, and we would be able to heat 18 pots of water with this one can of propane. All right, how about the generator directly to hot plate results? Now, this turned out to use more power than I expected. When I ran it, it took 9 minutes and consumed 113 grams of propane, which is about 1,575 watt hours, and puts us all the way down at 10% efficiency. We're only able to get 10% of the energy out of this to heat our water. So in that scenario, running the generator to heat the water, we would only be able to heat 4 pots of water. I think the moral of the story here is use a flame to heat water. So finally, the last scenario was using the generator to put energy in the batteries and then using the batteries. And of course, there's more stages of conversion losses there. And the result was it took 9.5 minutes, which it should be exactly the same since I'm using the same hot plate. So it's just a matter of my measurement timing there, but it's pretty close. And that took 386 grams of propane to put power in the batteries and then put the battery power back in the hot plate. 5,385 watts, almost an entire can of propane to heat one pot of water. And that puts us at an abysmal 2.9% efficiency. And the reality is I was able to heat one pot of water with the can, but I would have only been able to heat 1.2 pots of water. So I guess if you're in an emergency situation, direct flame is going to be the most efficient way to make use of your propane if you're heating something. And putting the power into a battery and using the battery to run your refrigerator would be the most efficient way to use the can of propane in that scenario. Well, this was really fun. I think we got some really interesting results, and you can see how dramatic the results are depending on what you're trying to achieve. A generator is the best place to start for emergency home backup. And in the short time that I've used this one for Max Peating Rods, it has worked really well. Plus, you can get a $50 discount if you use the code and the link in the description below. Later, adding solar and battery storage dramatically increases the efficiency and flexibility of your off-grid or emergency backup system. If you like this type of content, be sure and hit the like button so I know to produce more content like this. Be sure to check out one of these other videos on solar power and backup systems, or find me on my website, projectswithdave.com. If you have an idea for another experiment, let me know in the comments below. Or if you see any mistakes I made in my math or methods, be sure and let me know in the comments as well. Lots of great content coming up in the future, so be sure and stick around, and I'll see you next time.